This is the Regain Wellness Podcast with Jamie Logie, episode 136. Did the sugar industry mislead the public? Hey guys, what's happening? Welcome back to the podcast. I'm Jamie Logie. I run regainwellness.com, and this is the Regain Wellness podcast of the same name. Thank you for joining me here today, talking about, if you've been following, this is sort of mainstream-ish news, but if you follow anything like nutrition-related and health and wellness and stuff like that, you've seen this issue come up about the sugar industry with its, looks like, honestly, straight-up misleading of original studies that found sugar to cause heart disease and cardiovascular disease and the things that have been associated with saturated fat over the years, and that they, you know, stopped doing the research and sort of buried the data. And there's a whole bunch of info and stuff I'll cover. So that's what this whole show will be about, with the sugar issue kicked off by Def Leppard there. Honestly, probably my favorite band from the 80s, just straight up. I was obsessed with them as a kid. And Pour Some Sugar on Me would probably be their biggest hit of many, many great hits. So before we start and get into the whole deal, make sure, if you haven't already, to subscribe on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, like wherever you get your podcasts, it should be there. And if you're interested in sponsoring the show / me, I'm part of a thing called Patreon, which is like kind of a crowdfunded way to support things like, you know, podcasts and any artists, all sorts of stuff like that. But it's, you know, it starts as low as like $1 or $2 a month. And then if you support at different levels or there's different rewards. So like in my case, there's, you know, ebooks, nutrition guides, straight up like nutrition coaching, all sorts of stuff. So you can check that out at patreon.com/wellness. Okay, let's get into this whole thing now. Okay, so there'll be a lot of info in this, and a lot of what I'm looking at here is based on a lot of the information that came out through the New York Times, also in the Toronto Star here in Canada. Shout out to the Six, if you know what that means. And it's something, honestly, I've personally been aware of for a while, the idea that sugar was, you know, kind of considered the sort of root cause of the things that saturated fat was always attacked for. Not that saturated fat is completely off the hook here, but this info goes back quite a long way. And I'm even a couple years ago, I remember writing an article about it. And it's just one of those things that's sort of been in the mix for a while, and it's a little more mainstream. Maybe I just spent so much time, you know, reading and researching and learning about nutrition issues. So it's something that's always floated around there, but now it's a little more prominent, and I'll cover all that stuff in it. So like I said, a majority of the research will be based around what was reported through the New York Times. And the basis of everything is that the sugar industry was funding animal research in the 1960s that looked into the effects of sugar consumption on cardiovascular health. So, you know, and then that's connected with things like heart disease and, you know, certain cancers, but specifically like as that, you know, cardiovascular disease and heart disease being, you know, some of the top killers overall. And that was the investigation. So then when some of this info suggested that sugar could be harmful, they buried the data. And this is according to newly released historical documents. So these, I guess you can call them like what the article is referring to as internal industry documents that were through the sugar associations, and they were uncovered by researchers at the University of California in San Francisco, and they put them out in the, what is it, in the Journal of Biology on Tuesday. So what is this now, November 25th? So it's like less than a week ago. So the report's authors say it builds on evidence that the sugar industry has long tried to mislead the public and protect its economic interest by suppressing a lot of this really worrisome research and data, which we can only look back and see the tobacco industry doing the exact same thing. And the lid's been blown off that years and years ago. But it's the same thing through the 50s and 60s. They would just, the tobacco industry would fund their own research to try to, you know, downplay the effects of tobacco. And they would sort of squash anything that said tobacco was bad. And then they would bring in like their own researchers and doctors. And if you ever remember, you've probably seen these commercials on TV, the old commercials from the 50s and 60s, where there's doctors or people dressed up as doctors actually smoking, saying how, you know, cigarettes aren't bad. You can see like print advertisements, which are hilarious. I've used them before. I'll try and find one if I can link up on the show notes today, which will be regainedwellness.com/136. So that'll have all the stuff I'm talking about here. And there's actual advertisements where there's doctors talking about how, you know, cigarettes are smooth and calming, and it's got sort of drawn images of these friendly, helpful looking doctors that are smoking. And, you know, they build a whole industry on trying to cover up what was, you know, actually killing people. And, you know, later on we found it, and it's sugar's being looked at the same way. If you watched Mad Men, the series, which is brilliant, and just its way, like, it looks into how advertisements and Mad Men, like the Madison Avenue men who were creating these advertisements and marketing promotion, their jobs were to create these feelings and not just like necessarily push products. Whereas like in original advertising, say they're promoting a watch and they just be like, here's the watch, this is what it does. And then in the 50s and 60s with these guys in New York, the Don Drapers of the world, they would learn how they had to tie into people's emotions, because we buy based on feelings and emotions and what these things can bring us, not just the physical object. So all their marketing would be based around, this is, you know, selling you a feeling. And one of the big things in the whole series is the whole tobacco issue, because they're one of the, I think they work with Lucky Strike, and they're one of the big marketers for it. And it's been easy to sell it all, like, through all the years and years. And then a lot of these reports start coming out that, oh, it's causing cancer, and they're trying to get on top of this whole thing. And that's, you know, it leads into them, you know, trying to sell that feeling more and that emotion, and trying to get away from all that stuff. If you haven't watched Mad Men, it's brilliant just to see how we can be manipulated into what we buy and stuff like that. So basically it's just connecting the tobacco industry of, you know, suppressing worrisome research. And that's what the sugar industry is doing. So the documents that they have show in 1968, a trade group called the Sugar Research Foundation, which is now today known as the Sugar Association, funded a research project on animals to shed light on the connection between sugar and heart health. But when the research pointed to a mechanism by which sugar might promote not only heart disease, but then some other issues they didn't expect, like bladder cancer, the industry group ended the study and never published the results. They thought they were going to find out good news, and then the complete opposite happened, according to all this stuff. So obviously the sugar industry has, you know, always insisted that sugar has no unique role in promoting obesity, diabetes, or heart disease through numerous studies by, you know, independent researchers. You know, that if you look deeper, are a lot of the times Coca-Cola is infamous for this, like using their own networks and resources to find, you know, to do the studies to try to oppose the very thing they're selling, which is just a massive conflict of interest. If you ever look in studies that seem questionable and that they're up available online, you can track back the support and the funding from it, and you'll find some surprising stuff, and it happens all the time. So of course they're saying it's not causing these things, and then there's a ton of research that concludes otherwise. So the person here, I think their name's Stanton Glantz, who's a professor of medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, and he's one of the authors of the new report, said that even though these documents they've just discovered are about 50 years old, they're very important because they point to a, you know, decades long strategy to downplay the potential health effects of sugar consumption. And I think everyone's more and more aware of this all the time. Like, I've just been doing these episodes on how, you know, soft drink companies are so aware of this, or there's such a demand by people to get away from sugar that they're offering these things like Coke Zero Sugar or Coke Life or Pepsi. I forget what their version is, where it's, you know, they cut the sugar in a third and they don't use high fructose corn syrup and they try to use like a natural cane sugar. And they're, so, I mean, obviously everyone's aware of this. And I think we've probably already always known to stay away from sugar, but it's just interesting to see this stuff coming up now more and more. And this Stanton Glantz, Dr. Glantz, and he's just one of the people that's involved with, you know, continuing to build this case to show that the sugar industry has a long history of manipulating science. And it's honestly, it looks like it's complete, not that they're in cahoots, but it's along the same trajectory as the tobacco industry. And I think that's not too even bold of a statement. It seems like that's what it straight up is. So here's what the Sugar Association says. So they're disputing the report, obviously. They're calling it a, quote, collection of speculations and assumptions about events that happened nearly five decades ago, conducted by a group of researchers and funded by individuals and organizations that are known critics of the sugar industry, which I don't know, to me that really sounds like an actual dispute. It's just them trying to call foul on what they're doing. So the current research was funded mainly by the National Institutes of Health and the Laura and John Arnold Foundation, which is a private foundation that has given money to support taxes on sugary beverages. And the statement said that sugar, so this is, you know, from the Sugar Association people, sugar consumed in moderation is part of a balanced lifestyle. And it's emphasized that the Sugar Association remained committed to supporting research to further understand the role sugar plays in consumers' evolving eating habits, which is a tough thing to say, because you'll hear often people talk about you can't isolate one nutrient or food and vilify that, you know, whether it's fat or, you know, carbohydrates, and you can't point the finger at one thing. And they're saying that same thing with sugar, calling it, you know, one nutrient you can't attack. But to call sugar a nutrient is absolutely absurd. So watch out for that sort of kind of manipulation of the terms. Like, I mean, the word nutrient implies nutrition, and there's zero nutrition in sugar. It's maybe in its real raw state, which we will never eat, you know, from sugar cane or sugar beets. Yeah, you might actually get some nutrition from that. But when something is refined down and so isolated and concentrated, it's, and then, like I said, stripped down from everything, it's no longer really a nutrient. It's the same thing with salt. Like, natural sea salt, yeah, is probably pretty good for us, you know, in limited amounts and depending on your sodium issues, but it's full of a ton of, you know, micronutrients and trace minerals and stuff like that. But when table salt, like sodium chloride, is super refined down and heated, and there's zero nutrition in that. And it's not too much of a stretch either to look at sugar being completely non-nutritious and dangerous the same way cocaine is. So cocaine's derived from the coca leaf. Now, the coca leaf on its own, yeah, is actually probably not bad. People make a lot of teas out of it, especially in like South America, and it's been used to stave off altitude sickness, and it's a good antioxidant source and everything like that. But when it's refined down and concentrated and isolated into this refinement, which is cocaine, it's probably not too good for us. And it's the exact same thing with sugar. So to call it a nutrient is extremely dangerous. When there's zero nutrition in it, it's like picking up a piece of cardboard. The cardboard's probably better for you. There might be a little fiber in it, but it's just a stripped down version and a concentrated extraction that is just not real and has nothing to it. So more in this, the documents described in this new report are part of the sort of cache of internal sugar industry communications that a lady named Kristen E. Kearns, who was one of the assistant professors at the University of California, part of the School of Dentistry, actually discovered in one of the library archives. I don't know how she found this, but I think they're trying to look a little deeper, and all this stuff is right there. So this actually was kind of introduced last year. Like I said, this can, I'll get into it in a little bit, but this connection where sugar's been trying to point the negative effects it has and pointing them at saturated fat, like, goes back to the 60s as well too, and it's kind of been common knowledge. But as far as a mainstream sort of thing, this, you know, last year the New York Times again highlighted some of the different documents that this Dr. Kearns had uncovered, and it showed that the sugar industry launched this campaign in the 1960s to counter negative attitudes towards sugar, in part by them funding sugar research that could produce favorable results, not surprisingly, like I said, Coke being so notorious for doing. And the campaign was orchestrated by a guy named John Hixon, who's a top executive at the what is now the Sugar Association. And amazingly, this guy later joined the tobacco industry. So as part of the sugar industry campaign, this John Hixon secretly, and this is all in these documents, which you can read, he secretly paid two influential Harvard scientists to publish a major review paper in 1967 that minimized the link between sugar and heart health and shifted the blame to saturated fat, which is just incredible. And I don't know if more of this stuff's coming up now, because all the people that were involved with a lot of these original studies and trials are no longer with us. You know, they've passed away over the years, and no one can be really referenced into what's happening. So I think, like, with the sugar associations and stuff like that, they're saying, you know, all this, you know, research is, you know, maybe inconclusive and whatever. And they basically, you can't go any deeper than that, because the people who actually conducted this stuff can't back it up or explain what was happening. And at the same time, you've got this guy, this John Hixon, this top executive, paying off Harvard scientists to publish the reviews saying it's, you know, not that harmful. So the report that came out on the Tuesday, which is, what was that, 6 days ago, so the 21st? I don't know, something around that in November. This is 2017, depending when you're listening to this. And the report revealed additional internal sugar industry documents from the era, and they showed that this Mr. Hixon was worried at the time about emerging studies indicating that calories from sugar were more detrimental to heart health than calories from starchy carbohydrates, you know, like grains and beans and potatoes and stuff like that. And he suspected this might be because the microbes that reside in our gut, like our good gut bacteria, the microbiota, metabolizes sugars and starches completely differently depending on what the form of starch is. And some of the good, more, you know, complex carbohydrates, or things like they call resistant starches, actually can help feed the gut bacteria in a good way, whereas sugar can help the bad gut bacteria grow. There's sort of this balance you're trying to create in your gut bacteria between the good and the bad gut bugs, is basically the easiest way to put it. And the bad ones can feed on sugar, and it actually wants more and more. And when you crave sugar, it can be linked to actually this gut bugs craving the sugar. So it's almost completely out of your control, because I talk about this a lot. Your gut is your small intestine, where all your digestion and absorption starts to happen. And it's where your gut bacteria resides. And it's your small intestine is sort of considered your second brain in your body. And 2/3 of the neurotransmitters that your body makes, that's, you know, involved with the brain, as far as, you know, feel good hormones and serotonins and all that sort of thing, are made in the gut, and it controls so much. So when you're craving sugar, it's not only the addictive sort of narcotic effect that's hitting your actual brain, it's hitting your gut, your small intestine, which is like your second brain. So you're basically at the mercy of this major control function in your body. So it's no way we have, people say it's, you know, willpower and they give in and like, oh, I have no willpower. No, you're trying to fight against these mechanisms that you completely cannot combat against. They're that powerful and they're that controlling. So that was one of the things they were looking, you know, at the gut issue and, you know, finding out. And now we know more and more. This is, you know, back in the 60s where they're wondering about the whole issue of the microbes in the guts. And they thought, oh, all sugars and starches are the same and the gut deals with them the same. And we're learning that's not the case at all. And there's the different starches react with the different bugs in your microbiome and the whole deal, and how sugar works, and which is a whole massive thing, but interesting that they were looking into it even back then. So in this is the next year, 1968, the Sugar Organization starts what they call Project 259. And this group or this project recruited a researcher at the University of Birmingham. This is in England, not Alabama. Guy named W.F.R. Pover, and paid him the equivalent of almost 200 grand in today's dollars to conduct a laboratory study on animals. And the goal of this experiment was to test whether germ-free rats and guinea pigs that lacked gut bacteria would respond differently to sugar and starches than normal animals. So trying to see, are these, you know, they're just handled the exact same, or is there a difference, and is one affecting us more than the other? So the initial results then describe next, the year after, 1969, in their internal industry report, they found the results to be of, quote, particular interest, unquote, and that raised a concern. So the rats fed sucrose, the main component of cane sugar, had produced high levels of an enzyme called beta-glucuronidase. I think I'm always saying that right. Glucuronidase. That's what I'm going with. Which three other studies published around that time had associated with hardened arteries and bladder cancer, the stuff that usually saturated fats associated with, hardened arteries and bladder cancer, but they're finding that the sucrose was causing this enzyme to be secreted. So this is one of the quote here is, this is one of the first demonstrations of a biological difference between sucrose and starch-fed rats that the internal industry report, you know, that's what they stated, which had never occurred to them and never was thought to be apparently a conclusion. So the documents show that this Dr. Pover found something else highly significant. The initial phase of the research appeared to confirm that sugar's adverse effects on cholesterol and triglycerides were a result of it being metabolized and fermented by gut bacteria. Like I said, it just feeds on this stuff and can create all these bad issues. And at the same time, the gut bacteria is craving more and more. So when you're eating sugar, you're feeding this gut bacteria, and in turn, it's altering and affecting your cholesterol and your triglycerides. So this Dr. Pover said at the time that he was close to the completion of this Project 259, the testing of starches and sugars on gut bacteria in rats, but he needed an extension to prove conclusively that the effects he was seeing were mediated by the microbiota. So he just wanted to look further and further, but despite having granted him a previous extension, the sugar industry pulls the plug on this whole Project 259, immediately eliminates the fundings, because the results are shocking. They didn't know sugar was connected to these things. And in another internal report, this is all, I can put this whole, the entire report thing is all online, like the New York Times linked it up. And there's a link in the article to the actual full report, which I did read, and it's massive and very interesting, but I can link that up if you want to see it. So regainwellness.com/136. So in this internal report then in 1970, so this has gone over from 67, 68, 69, then 1970, that Hickson guy I was telling you about updated the sugar executives on the studies that could elicit useful and significant information for the industry, and then describes the value of that whole Project 259 as quote unquote nil, that there was nothing to it. So the industry report suggested that the Dr. Pover, who was conducting the original, those studies with the rats, was disappointed, noting that he expressed hopes of obtaining continuing support from the other sources. Basically, it's like, long story short, the sugar industry freaks out over what he's finding as far as the heart disease issue, cholesterol, triglycerides, all being linked to sugar, and how it absolutely, what's the word, just sort of contorts and deforms our gut bacteria into creating these conditions in the body. And this guy, Pover. And he's wanting to look further, and he's, you know, this is alarming stuff. He wants more support. They give him none. He never succeeded in going farther. The research was never published. And again, you can't look into it more because this Dr. Pover and that Hickson guy, they're no longer alive. So you can't follow up. You can't dig deeper. Again, back to the Sugar Association, one of their spokespeople said that the group reviewed its research archives and determined that Dr. Pover's study ended because it was delayed over budget and had overlap with an organizational restructuring, which sounds like a lot of crap. Who knows? Maybe that's true. But for a guy who, according to all the reports, was very disappointed, wanted to continue going, he wanted continued support, even if it had to be from other sources, just to investigate further. So there were plans to continue the study with funding from the British Nutrition Foundation, just I think because it was being done at the University of Birmingham. And the statement then says in this report, but for reasons unbeknown to us, this did not occur. So, you know, who knows at that point. So some other interesting takeaways here. I'm going to get to the Ansel Keys thing in a second. But what's, I think that the most alarming thing is everyone knows the tobacco issue and that the lid was blown off that, but it's more concerning now to see this, you know, rare evidence that the food industry suppressed research it did not like. And like with cigarettes, I think from the get-go, you know, they're bad for you. The idea of, you know, inhaling smoke and exhaling it, I mean, straight up, you know, whatever, but you know, sugar has been used for a long time and it's been, you know, included in so much in our lives, from, you know, baking cookies to drinks to, you know, making your own lemonade to all these things that aren't associated potentially with harmful health, but as far as feeding yourself and nutrition. But interesting that it would go that far back that, and it, the thing I find interesting is that they needed to start doing these studies. Like, they did have this concern. And then back in 1967, that the industry itself started to look at it. So whether it's, you know, from the public concern or they were just, you know, like it was a lot of outside other industries that were finding the problems too, but the fact that it was that much of an issue they went in, and that in that day and age is a lot easier to sort of put the squash on something and not have it leak out per se. And I think from what the paper is saying is there, the sugar industry's big concern was they didn't want to answer open-ended questions about whether sugar might be harmful. You know, whether it's to the rats or to us, given the like early suggestions that there was possible harm and, you know, not wanting to do further studies to find out one way or another, just the fact that people would ask the question, is this maybe not good for us? They really didn't want to get into those discussions. Like, it's not even saying it's straight up good or bad. Just the very issue of, is this something we should be concerned about? That freaked them out, apparently. So the fact that they wanted to start looking at it and then they didn't like what they found. If you're wondering about the issue, like, you know, how many studies are done on people as compared to rats, that's obviously very valid. And I think with some of the animals, with rats, like, I think they have a similar digestive system as far as the gut and the small intestine and all that sort of stuff. And some people are like, oh, it's rats, it doesn't connect to us. And yeah, that might be true. And, you know, it has been looked at with some human studies, but there's not as many. And it's, you know, but in the 60s, animal data held much more weight in research and stuff like that. And a federal law at the time banned food additives that had been shown to induce cancer in animals. And in 1969, for example, the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, banned cyclamate, which was a artificial sweetener, after research showing it caused bladder cancer in rats. So they've been always, animal testing, like, whatever you feel about it, against it or for it or whatnot, it always has been one of the more solid ways to investigate concerns over, you know, food additives or actually nutrition intake or whatever. And just remember at the time that those animal studies held that much amount of weight. So that's why they still responded and sort of freaked out over the findings. An interesting thing as well with the cyclamate, that artificial sweetener. And I recommend, if you want to hear more about government interference with approving or disproving food additives and substances. Listen to the show I did on the whole aspartame issue if you want to just be horrified and outraged at how this stuff got approved and allowed to be consumed by people. I'll link that episode up too. It pretty nuts. So an interesting thing with the cyclamate is, so, you know, the research showed that it, you know, could cause bladder cancer in rats. And at the time, the Sugar Association considered cyclamate a threat to its market share. Again, people are already aware maybe we should be avoiding sugar. So they're trying to find artificial sweeteners so they can cut sugar out of products, until aspartame came along again in the, not too long after this, around in, I think 1969, 70 is when it started going. But this is a little bit earlier on. Sugar Association's worried that cyclamate's going to cut into their profits, and had not only lobbied the FDA to remove it, but also, it turns out, funded some of the research linking it to the health problems that they found in the rats. So as I, you know, reference the issue with the studies of animals and lab animals and how it, you know, went into what they found with this, you can look even further and it finds out that maybe they were involved in that. Hickson guy, as mentioned before, who was part of the sugar industry, who left to go work for the tobacco industry. He actually went to work for the Cigar Research Council, which is a tobacco industry organization. And in 1972, an internal tobacco industry memo on Hickson notes he had a reputation for manipulating science to achieve his goals. And the confidential tobacco memo described him as a supreme scientific politician who had been successful in condemning cyclamate on behalf of the Sugar Research Council on what they said was very shaky evidence. So you can just see when it comes to these things, when we talk about, like, you know, big sugar and big farming and big tobacco and, you know, the overseeing sort of governing bodies of it, when they're really looking out for their best interest, what it can do. And this is just an example of all that. So this opens up the whole can of worms about, so why then, you know, where did the idea that saturated fat actually cause all these things? Like I said, the sugar industry was finding, you know, wait, sugar actually might be causing those things. And they sort of pushed that issue onto saturated fat. They're saying, oh no, it's causing the raises in cholesterol and triglyceride levels, and it's causing the heart disease and the cardiovascular health problems. So now, actually, like, I'm tying more and more of this together, so I might be drawing a few of my own conclusions, but it comes down to a guy I mentioned before named Ansel Keys. And he was an American scientist who, around this time, more in the 50s, but getting in the 60s, was starting to look at why heart disease, you know, which had not been a problem three decades prior, was now the number one killer in America. And this guy conducted what was called the 7-country study to look into why this is so. And looking back, you know, maybe he already had a conclusion in his head that was potentially influenced by someone else, in this case, the sugar industry. And now I'm wondering if this is the whole deal. So what he did was he looked at 7 countries, United States, Finland, Netherlands, Italy, Yugoslavia, Croatia, and Serbia. And he handpicked these countries that showed heart disease problems from, you know, higher saturated fat intake. But he didn't include places where there was a very high saturated fat intake, yet they did not suffer from high rates of heart disease, like France, Switzerland, Sweden, at the time West Germany. And he also left off countries that had a high heart disease rate, but a really low saturated fat intake, such as Chile. So he had access to 22 different countries that had available data, but he only selected the few that matched his hypothesis, which, you know, is called blatant cherry picking. If you play hockey, a cherry picker is the guy who waits up way ahead of the play, waiting for the long bomb pass, who doesn't have to do the work down low, gets the easy result, goes in and tries to get a scoring chance on a breakaway. That's what he did. He didn't do the hard work looking in. And now that I look back on this, maybe this was straight up the case that he was getting influenced, maybe potentially paid by the sugar industry, like they were paying these Harvard scientists, because he had this idea in his head, ignores all this other data, and out of 22 countries only picks, I don't know, it seems a little even more sketchy at the time. This is what I was saying, like this idea has been up for a little while that sugar might have been the issue. And then Keyes, this Ansel Keyes guy became a part of the committee for the American Heart Association. And basically he had more of an ability to persuade, and almost from reading about the guy, like he bullied his viewpoint in that became kind of the standard. There was, you know, and at the time there's all this skepticism by the committees, even if, you know, associated with the American Heart Association, and the guy just was able to manipulate his message through. And either way, the advice was to avoid saturated fat. And this has been, I don't know, almost like indoctrinated into us. It's almost like gospel. I think there was a Time Magazine article that came out back then talking to, you know, the issue of avoiding saturated fat. And to this day, it's still in our heads about why we have to avoid it, and that it causes all these, you know, heart disease issues and stuff, when a lot of the research now is saying, wait, it's maybe not actually causing this. And now we're looking at, oh, maybe it is the sugar that's been causing this. And we look back at the sugar industry kind of suppressing all this information. Interesting as well with Ansel Keys, like the criticisms go back that far, and the criticism of the 7-country study that was saying saturated fat was causing heart disease. He was saying there was a tenuous association between the two, and he never actually came out and said that there was any possible proof of the causation. And again, like this is a whole can of worms. Again, you can keep going deeper and deeper into the whole thing, and you can go back and actually see his, like I said, I've read a lot of the stuff involved with them, and he actually acknowledged that he didn't observe the association with saturated fat and heart disease. And he said, quote, "The evidence both from experiments and field surveys indicates that the cholesterol content per se of all natural diets has no significant effect on either the serum cholesterol level or the development of heart disease in man." And that's from the dude's own words. So it's interesting then with the whole sugar thing, there was a guy at the time as well named John Yudkin, and he wrote a book called Pure, White, and Deadly. And he was looking at this thing we've been talking about today, showing the incredible toxic effects of sugar on our bodies, including its ability to cause heart disease, let alone diabetes and obesity and all that sort of thing. And the thing with this Yudkin guy, apparently he was very soft-spoken. He wasn't aggressive, and he was trying to get the same message out, where this Ansel Keys guy was able to kind of take his message and more loudly proclaim it. Maybe he was getting his pockets filled, and that's why he was more, you know, kind of singing it from the mountaintops, because there was more a financial interest for him. And the problem with at the time, so say this John Yudkin guy, you know, it's harder to get your message out then. You couldn't put up a website. You couldn't blog about it. You couldn't put a Facebook post or tweet it. If you have, like I said, his book came out. Books could take years to get from the written stage to publishing to in the stores. So that's such a long term to get your message out. Where in the meantime, this Ansel Keys guy gets his message sort of shouted above the sugar effect issue. And, you know, it gets in the magazine and whatever. And it's just, the more you look back and read this, the issue was there. People were trying to talk about, wait, maybe it's sugar, maybe it's not the saturated fat. And you're looking at this guy, you know, just taking select pieces of data and trying to come to these conclusions. So yeah, it's a whole mess of stuff. But again, when it comes to industry and money and anything like that, you know, the big picture and, you know, ultimately the dollar reigns supreme over correct information and people's health. And I think we can see it not only how we saw it in tobacco, but we're seeing it in this situation. And one last thing I was looking at too, as far as where the issue of the saturated fat and the sugar and our consumption and what it was leading to during the time of these works. So this is in the 60s. Fats and oils supplied around 45% of calories, and around 13% of adults were obese, and under 1% had type 2 diabetes. Today, we're taking in way less fat. We get around 33% of calories from fats and oils, yet 34% of adults are obese and 11% have diabetes. And as of this year, it's even way higher. This is back from a couple years ago. The obesity rates are through the roof. Fat content is down more than ever. We're starting to eliminate sugar as well too. Sugar intake is starting to go down, but it's still massively overly consumed. You'd just be shocked how much sugar you're consuming on a daily basis, even if you're conscious of trying to avoid it. I mean, sugar's in everything from like cough medicines to salad dressings to frozen dinners to like just in places you would never expect, crackers, soups, you know, it's absolutely everywhere. So you can be physically trying like, okay, I'm avoiding soft drinks. I'm not drinking Coke. I'm not actually adding table sugar, but it still is like creeping up on you in all these different ways. So I think that's interesting to see what the actual ratios of what we were consuming at the time and what they're getting like today. So I'll kind of wrap it there. I know this sort of leaves it open-ended, but I think that's a good thing for you to go and maybe look into this issue a little more. Like I said, it's like a labyrinth that kind of opens itself up. And Labyrinth was an awesome movie with the late David Bowie and a young Jennifer Connelly. But like I said, start looking more. Like, I can link up, if you go to the show notes again today, regainwellness.com/136, I'll put all the articles up. So like the New York Times article, the one from last year that was starting this thing, and then the actual report that you can read that was linked into the article from all the stuff they're finding. And I'll put the article I have on the Ansel Keys saturated fat. Like I said, entire podcast can be like, not just episode, but podcast can be just about this whole issue. So trying to like scratch the surface a little bit, but it's something you might want to read up more. And I think that it might be good actually to leave this on a note of a little more intrigue, maybe even a little bit of possible confusion, because that's where you actually have to do the work and start investigating these things to learn more and educate yourself. It's not like a black and white issue, like, boom, we're going to cover it in a 30-minute podcast. You've got all the answers. No, it should motivate and encourage you to start looking more. And that's how you really find the best health and nutrition information, is when you start to look at the big picture and you start to like actually connect the dots. And obviously we're still doing it now. Like, this research only came out like a week ago that they're finding all this stuff, and who knows what else we'll keep finding as it goes. So keep looking into it. Keep informing yourself, keep educating yourself. Hopefully shows like this are a good jumping off point and help you in that whole pursuit. And I think I'll end it there. So thank you for taking the time to listen. I appreciate it. And again, I know there's a lot of podcasts just in general, like health and nutrition ones, that cover this, or they maybe cover it more deeply or not deeply enough. So the fact you're listening to this one, that means a lot. And it means you have a big interest in your own health, that you're trying to look more into these issues. So again, use this as the jumping off point. Don't take it as straight up gospel, but move forward from here and keep finding out as much as you can. And hopefully this and stuff like this helps you on the way as well. But thank you for listening. If you have any questions on this or other things you want to see covered or whatever, write me at info@regainwellness.com. If you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to the podcast. You automatically get it sent to you. If you really like it, leave a rating and review. Then more people get to see it, and I can put that rating and review up on my fridge, and my mom's proud of me and the whole deal. Okay, I'm done. Thank you. See you soon.